Now on BBC One, Fergus Walsh reports upon the race for a vaccine in Panorama.
Vials of liquid hope coming off the production line. A vaccine developed in the UK against COVID-19. It could be approved by Christmas.
There's never been a year of progress scientifically like this in my lifetime.
You know, it was worth it because we'd worked really hard. I think we all had a little cry.
This is the story of the scientists who designed it, the doctor who led the trials, the team who helped them, and the volunteers who made it all possible. I'm the BBC's medical editor, and over the past year, I've followed their story. The race to make a vaccine to end the pandemic.
Scientists in China are trying to determine if a new virus strain is responsible for pneumonia.
Authorities have reported 27 cases in total, 7 of which are critical.
I have a brother. He was in China at the time. So any outbreaks that happen in China, I do tend to listen and pay attention.
The number of cases has increased to 44, with 11 of them in serious condition.
I first read about an outbreak of SARS-like pneumonia from a website that reports on disease outbreaks. Really caught my attention because we've been thinking about how are we going to respond when a new virus emerges and it might spread quickly and we don't have a vaccine.
At the beginning of the year, the first cases of a mysterious new disease were reported in Wuhan. Over 5,000 miles away in Oxford, this team of scientists thought they might be able to create a vaccine for it.
At that stage, it wasn't apparent what type of outbreak this would be, but it certainly had pandemic potential. The information that we needed to design the vaccine arrived in my inbox early Saturday morning. The ping woke me up, I still remember. It was the genetic coding sequence for the virus. And what we had that information, that tiny bit of the sequence from the coronavirus, and used that to put into our platform vaccine technology. And then I worked on it over the weekend.
So were you working remotely or were you in the lab?
I'm afraid it wasn't quite as glamorous as that. It was pajama wearing in my bedroom over a computer trying to get this done with my colleagues. My family didn't see me very much that weekend, but I think that set the tone for the rest of the year.
By Monday morning, on the 13th of January, the vaccine was designed.
Some ominous developments out of China on a new illness. Officials there have just confirmed the first human-to-human transmission of coronavirus. It's a huge story.
Is that it makes it more difficult to contain the spread when human-to-human transmission is a factor here.
By the middle of January, it was clear that all of the features that you would really worry about an emerging infections, you know, no immunity in mankind, no vaccine, no drug, no diagnostic, an animal virus in a big city, just before Chinese New Year, in the winter months. And then it was spread by respiratory route, by coughing and sneezing over people. I mean, those are all of the features all together that make you worry.
As cases rose in China, the new virus caught the attention of Professor Andrew Pollard, who runs clinical trials at the Oxford Vaccine Group.
I went to a meeting in France to talk about our work on typhoid. And in the taxi from the airport, I went with one of the modellers who's been working with SAGE and chatted with him about this virus that was emerging from China. And he said from the data they had, there was going to be a pandemic that affected the world that was not going to be very different from the way the 1918 flu was. And in that taxi journey, I went from someone who was aware of a small outbreak in China, which was of academic interest, to realising that it was going to change our lives this year. And it was a chilling moment.
I wanted to get the money to make a vaccine ready for a clinical trial and then do that first clinical trial. And Andy Pollard was the obvious collaborator to ask from the very early stage to come and help me with that.
I head the clinical biomanufacturing facility, which is a small manufacturing suite inside the University of Oxford.
I was thinking about the vaccine manufacturing so that we could go into clinical trials, the clinical testing in animals that we were going to need to do, because we needed all of that and it all had to happen as soon as we could.
Sarah Gilbert emailed me to say, we've noticed that there's clearly something big happening in Wuhan and we need to work on developing quickly a vaccine against that, just to give me a heads up that there might be some involvement required from me.
I think probably the first big team meeting we had was a key moment where a lot of people started to realise that this was going to be something big that we were going to be working on together.
The team could move so quickly because of the template they used to design experimental vaccines for diseases like malaria, flu, and crucially, a different coronavirus called MERS. Each vaccine they create uses a harmless virus which can deliver genetic instructions to human cells to build an immune response. This template meant that once they had the new coronavirus code, it took just 48 hours to design the vaccine. A full month after the vaccine was designed, the disease caused by the new coronavirus finally got a name.
And it is COVID-19, and I will spell it COVID-19.
But getting funding to take the Oxford vaccine into clinical trials was a struggle.
That was really all I thought about for about 3 months. It was my job to get the money, and that's why I was getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning to write the next bit of the grant application. And talking to government, talking to other funders.
We expect to see the number of cases, the number of deaths, and the number of affected countries climb even higher.
Animal studies would have to be conducted and the vaccine prepared for human trials. Meanwhile, the World Health Organization finally acknowledged the virus was spreading out of control.
We have therefore made the assessment that COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
All schools across Britain will close by the end of the week until further notice as the death toll from coronavirus reached 104.
On the 23rd of March, the UK was put into lockdown.
Without a huge national effort to halt the growth of this virus, there will come a moment when no health service in the world could possibly cope.
That day, the government announced funding to support clinical trials and manufacturing. But lockdown meant significant challenges.
Because you couldn't even buy hand sanitizer in Boots, let alone at commercial suppliers. So I was mixing hand sanitizer in my lab and bringing that in. And we were just trying to keep everybody safe because we knew we were crucial.
The logistics are enormous. And of course, they were even harder during lockdown because we could not get supplies. We were phoning all over Europe to get thermometers to be able to measure the temperature of our volunteers, because there were no thermometers that were available. We were short of supplies of PPE, which we needed for our staff in the clinics. It was an absolute logistical nightmare.
It is completely unimaginable, and we're not at the peak yet.
At the time, I visited one of London's busiest intensive care units.
So it's oxygen
and organ support and amazing nursing care, really.
Witnessing the brutal reality of COVID.
I've been in intensive care nursing for about 23 years now, and I've never seen anything like this.
The only real exit strategy was a vaccine. But to find one that was safe and effective would require volunteers.
We opened our database as an online database and had 10,000 people sign up within a matter of hours.
The first doses were made here at the university's own biomanufacturing facility. the harmless, modified virus which forms the vaccine was grown in a culture of adapted human cells.
You just grow a little bit of the culture, you take that and put it into a bigger culture and it grows. You take that, you put it into a bigger culture, it grows.
The end result was billions of particles of the modified virus.
We keep the starting material at minus 80 temperatures for long-term storage. This is the very first generation of the vaccine. It's made here in Oxford.
After 7 weeks, there were enough doses to start the trial.
My team were working round the clock, so we just compressed everything and we didn't wait for the results of one stage before we went on to the next stage. So we took a risk with the project. We still did the checks, and if the checks had come back as a fail, we'd have had to throw away the things we'd done. But the only way to do it quickly was to just push straight through this to the end.
We didn't have that vaccine ready to use until the day that we wanted to vaccinate people. So it was all very much rapid progress and dealing with many, many, many small problems just to keep the project moving.
One of the biggest steps for me and was monumental for me was the vaccination of the first individual. And I remember walking home from the lab and almost breaking down because we'd got a vaccine and we got it into somebody's arm.
Elisa Granato, a microbiologist, was the first person in Europe to be immunised on a COVID vaccine trial.
Okay, so I need a scratch.
I'm a scientist, so of course I want to try and support science, the scientific process, whenever I can. And since I don't study viruses, I felt a bit useless these days, so I felt like this is a very easy way for me to support the cause. Yeah, that's why I'm here, and I'm excited.
Now it's all done. Okay, well done.
Thank you. I'm just basically going to sit here and incubate this thing and hopefully provide some good follow-up data, and then we'll see, and hopefully it works.
Edward O'Neill, a cancer researcher, was also vaccinated that day. As a safety precaution, the team waited 48 hours to check that Elisa and Edward had no serious adverse reactions.
That's it.
Both were well. So the team immunised 6 more volunteers and gradually ramped up the numbers being vaccinated.
I don't really feel nervous about it. I think it's been nice to get out of the house.
The vaccine is created from an adenovirus, a type of virus that causes the common cold in chimpanzees, disabled so it can't cause an infection in humans. They insert a tiny fragment of genetic code, in this case, from the coronavirus surface spike. When this modified cold virus is injected, it breaks into human cells, where the fragment of coronavirus genetic code that it contains programs cells to make surface spikes that are identical to those found on coronavirus. The body's immune system learns to recognize these distinctive surface spikes, so when the real coronavirus comes along, the immune system is primed and ready. This was a randomized controlled trial, so the volunteers were split into two. Half were testing the COVID vaccine. The others, the control group, were given a meningitis jab, chosen because this can also cause mild side effects. Neither volunteers nor scientists knew who was in which group.
They're going to be randomized to get either the COVID-19 vaccine or the meningitis. You won't know what you're getting. We don't know if the COVID-19 vaccine is going to work, so please don't assume any protection against COVID-19. So happy to continue?
Yeah, happy.
Lovely.
Only a few days after receiving her vaccine, there were shocking claims on social media that Elisa had died. It wasn't true.
So a lot of work had to be done to, for her sake, as well as for the trial's sake, to make it clear that this was just fake news.
I spoke to her that day.
Elisa, reports of your death have been greatly exaggerated. You're alive and well.
I am indeed alive and well. Thank you very much. I'm doing great. I feel absolutely fine.
Any side effects so far?
No, I feel absolutely great. Never been better, actually. I'm just out and about, living my life.
But while easy to disprove, it was just one of many conspiracy theories online.
waking up to think how malicious that can be, how people are really spreading nasty things about people, and that doesn't feel fair because my team are all doing their best.
In reality, the trial was going well, and by late May, 1,000 volunteers aged 18 to 55 had been enrolled. Among them were the Viney family, Tony, Katie, and Rhiannon.
I guess it was my idea. I saw it on Facebook and I sent the link to Mum and Dad and was like, would you like to participate? And they were like, yeah.
We wanted to do something that felt like we were helping in some way and thought, well, this is something that I can do.
I travelled alone to my vaccine and it was when I pulled up in the car park, I thought, well, it's now or never, you know. Once you've done this, there's no going back. But I walked in there bold as brass and felt great about it, truthfully.
They were asked to keep a note of any unusual symptoms.
I had to fill in the e-diary for the first time, and that was quite a long set of questions for the first 7 days, asking of any fever, of any nausea, of any chills, of any... lots and lots and lots of questions, and I had to answer no to every one of them because I just felt normal.
It is just incomprehensible to think that the entire world has ground to a halt, and if this vaccine is the way that we get out of this, then, you know, that is the biggest thing to hit all of us, hopefully, in our lifetimes.
The team at Oxford had the goal of creating an affordable vaccine that could help the whole world. But to do that, they'd need billions of doses, something only a big pharmaceutical company could provide.
The university was very clear that no profit should be made by anybody on our research during the pandemic period, and that vaccines should be made available for low and middle income countries free of charge, even after the pandemic.
And of course, that's a difficult one, because that's not usually the way that big pharma works.
They started negotiations with Mene Pangalos of the Cambridge-based pharmaceutical giant AstraZeneca.
Obviously, there were discussions about the not-for-profit. There were discussions about would we ever make a profit in the developed world, in the wealthy countries.
You know, they weren't the only company that we had some early discussions with, but when we started talking to AstraZeneca, we realised they were also prepared to take the risk that it wasn't going to work, because we couldn't work with a company who would just make enough vaccine for the clinical trials and wait and see if we got good efficacy before deciding whether to invest in manufacturing, because that would be too slow. So we needed somebody who could take the financial risk.
AstraZeneca was not an obvious choice. They only have one licensed vaccine.
In terms of AstraZeneca, I mean, they're actually not known as a vaccine company.
What was critical about AstraZeneca was that they, although they don't make many vaccines, they do have the networks that we need to tap into for the manufacturing around the world.
AstraZeneca agreed not to make a profit from the vaccine during the pandemic and afterwards to sell it at cost price to low and middle income countries. In a huge vote of confidence, the government agreed to buy 100 million doses should the vaccine prove successful, and provided nearly £90 million in support. The US government pledged 10 times that figure, partly to fund American trials.
Hello. Hi, you look very well.
Thank you.
4 weeks after the first volunteers were immunised, Elisa and Edward returned for vital blood tests.
Hi, how are you doing?
Not too bad.
If the vaccine was working, then by now, their immune system should have developed a response to coronavirus detectable in their blood. Katie Ewer's team will analyse their samples.
They're really the earliest indication we have that the vaccine might do something useful. So as soon as we've vaccinated people, we can start collecting those blood samples, testing for antibodies and T cells, because we know if we've got those, then we have a chance. If the vaccine induces no immune response at all, then we have a serious problem and we probably need to go back to the drawing board.
Yeah, will you check the serum?
Yeah.
If you have antibodies now against the coronavirus.
That's a lot of bottles.
but it's only a couple of milliliters.
Yeah.
Looks more than it, yeah. than it is.
Yeah. We're all curious to know. I mean, you must be curious to know if...
What's in there?
What's in there?
Yeah, pretty much.
Are there the antibodies in there? I mean,
We'll see.
Yeah.
A lot was riding on this. Failure now would have meant redesigning the vaccine.
We need to begin processing within 4 hours of the sample being collected, because after that, those cells will start to die.
This cellular detective work meant looking for clues as to whether the volunteers were building defences against coronavirus. Antibodies and T cells are key parts of the immune system. Antibodies are the first line of defense. They stick to the surface spikes of coronavirus and neutralize them, preventing them from infecting cells. T cells seek out those cells that have become infected and destroy them. Theresa Lamb's team looked for evidence of antibodies.
We're very excited to have these samples in the lab today, and we're very excited to see the readouts.
Hi.
How are the cell counts?
Yeah, all good.
While Katie Ewers worked on T cells, to do that required separating the blood by spinning it in a centrifuge.
So this is the blood sample. You can see we've got these different layers now. So at the bottom here are the red blood cells, and here we've got this fuzzy white layer. And in this layer are the cells of the immune system. These are the T cells that we're going to measure.
Katie's postgrad student, Rebecca, removes the top layer. She then pipettes the white blood cell layer onto plates, which contain fragments of coronavirus. If the volunteers' immune systems have been stimulated by the vaccine, that will show up later as small spots on the plates.
Each spot is like the footprint of a cell that's recognised the virus and made a response to it. We hope to see lots of spots in those early spot wells, because that shows that the immune response is making lots of T cells that can recognise the virus and clear it from the body.
The samples are loaded into a machine which will count how many spots have been created in each sample.
Back in the olden days, when I started my PhD, we used to do this by hand with a magnifying lens, like an Inspector Clouseau magnifying glass, and used to count them, and then you go to the next one and count that. Yeah.
Which is more accurate?
This. Definitely this, yeah. Tired PhD students probably don't do the most accurate spot counting, I don't think.
Many of the circles are covered with spots, clear signs of T cell activity.
It's great relief to see those immune responses. You know, as immunologists, that's what we do day in, day out. And for a vaccine that was as important as this, the pressure is there even more to show a good response.
The samples also showed evidence of antibodies.
We were really happy and we were really excited, because you see the results coming true as colour changes in a test, but you don't know whether those results are in the control or in a vaccinated individual. And it's only until we saw the results unblinded by our stats team did we really know that we had a vaccine that was inducing a strong immune response.
It was an encouraging start, but these were just the blood results from the first volunteers. Much more data would be needed before they'd know if the vaccine really worked. By now, there were nearly a dozen coronavirus vaccines in human trials around the world. Among the leading contenders were vaccines from Pfizer-BioNTech and Moderna, part of an unprecedented scientific response to the pandemic.
Really important that we have a number of vaccines going forward, because there is not one vaccine that can do the whole world, and we need lots of them. So having 2, 3, 4, 5, the more the merrier.
The Oxford team needed thousands more doses to expand their trials.
We're only a small manufacturer. We only make a 10-litre culture, and from that we get about 600 or so doses. So those doses were soon run out.
So they ordered a batch to be manufactured in Italy. But when they tested it, they worried the vaccine levels were too concentrated. So to be on the safe side and in agreement with the independent regulator, they injected volunteers with half the normal amount, but it turned out they'd been overcautious.
It was clear that the volunteers were having less immediate reactions. You know, when you have a vaccination, you get swelling, sometimes a little bit of fever and elevated temperature. Clear that we were getting less of those when we were using this new batch of vaccine than we had been when we used our original batch of vaccine.
More than 1,000 participants had been inadvertently given a half dose.
We immediately, when we found out, told the regulators. They understood the mistake and they said continue, as we wanted to as well. It's actually a really good way of exploring two different dose regimens, a half dose full dose and a full dose full dose.
The regulators' agreement to keep this group in the trial would turn out to be highly significant. The trials grew to 19 sites across the UK. The clinical and scientific teams were busier than ever.
Many of our scientists here at every level, from the most senior down to the most junior students, working on this because there is just such a huge amount of work to do.
I think now is a very exciting time to be working in vaccines. Started doing malaria, Ebola, which are great diseases to be involved in and very interesting and very, very worthy of our time, but I've never worked on something that's been so close to home before.
We've never vaccinated this many people in this scale of time, and that's a huge challenge.
We've been turning up to the lab at 8 a.m. and then we would be in there till 1 in the morning, 2 in the morning, and then going home, going to bed, trying to sleep and going back and doing the exact same thing again. There were hours that I have never worked before in my life.
By the start of summer, COVID infections here had fallen dramatically. While good news for most of us, it made things more difficult for the vaccine trial. It relied on volunteers being exposed to coronavirus in their daily lives in order to figure out if the vaccine was protecting them.
It was clear that we were now chasing the tail end of the first wave. And there was a real risk that we wouldn't be able to get the answers that we'd hoped for really quickly.
Frontline healthcare workers were a priority for the trials. They faced a higher risk of coming into contact with the virus. In June, I visited Newcastle's Royal Victoria Infirmary, where 500 NHS volunteers were immunised in a few days.
So why did you sign up for the vaccine trial?
Unfortunately, my dad fell ill with COVID and was admitted here for 8 days. And I think once it's been that close to home, it makes more of a difference. You want, feel like you want to do your bit.
One of the other volunteers that day was Veena, a consultant ophthalmologist.
Some parts of the examination and the treatment involve getting very close to the patient. My concern was that the patients we treat are very vulnerable.
Bright light coming up.
When I heard about the vaccine trials, you know, I thought this is something that, you know, this, we really need to grasp this chance with both hands.
For a vaccine intended for global use, it was important to run international trials.
I was extremely keen that we were testing in multiple different regions of the world, because it's important both for the generalizability of the vaccine, does it work in other places, but also to build confidence in different populations that the vaccine has been tested there.
They targeted countries with high levels of infection.
Brazil has the world's second largest outbreak behind the United States, from Sao Paulo.
The biggest city in the Amazon, where they're digging mass graves known as trenches.
It's under control here in Brazil.
The virus was spiraling out of control in Brazil. Soon, it would have the second highest death toll in the world after the United States.
I was in Brazil when Professor Pollard called me and
He was looking for a country to conduct the trials where he could prove quicker the efficacy and where we could do trials with quality and fast recruitment. We started initially with 2,000 subjects, then we increased to 5,000 subjects, and finally 10,000 subjects, which is just recruited. I really believe in what we are doing, and especially with the high number of cases that we still have in Brazil, I believe that we can prove efficacy soon.
Since the start of the trial back in April, the Oxford team had been testing samples from every volunteer, looking for signs of an immune response. On the 20th of July, they released their initial results.
It was a slightly odd feeling, because quite often we publish these papers and some people in our field will be interested in them. But I've never before been a co-author on a paper that has then had my phone buzz with BBC breaking news.
Today at 6, scientists at Oxford reach a really important milestone in their work on a vaccine for coronavirus. The vaccine is said to be safe, based on trials involving more than 1,000 people.
We were able to show that both the antibodies were made which neutralise the virus and stop it infecting our cells, but also that we were inducing T cells, which are absolutely critical for being able to fight the virus after it's already infected our cells. And so having those two components of the immune system working told us that we may well have a vaccine that could protect people.
It was a good moment. It was clear that this vaccine was doing what it was meant to be doing. We have a vaccine that is generating a good immune response. It looks like it's well tolerated, and this has a real chance of being a globally useful vaccine to curb the pandemic.
Like most of those on the trial so far, the Vineys had been given just a single dose of vaccine. But a few who'd got a second dose showed a much stronger immune response. That meant asking volunteers to have a booster dose, sometimes months after their initial injection.
Maddie, come on through. Have a temperature?
Yeah.
We will have some blood,
yeah.
And after we will have the booster. All right.
But one dose or two, no one knew yet whether the immune response was strong enough to protect the volunteers from actually getting COVID-19. And up until this point, they'd only tested the vaccine on people aged between 18 and 55.
For some vaccines, like the flu vaccine, for example, older people don't make such a strong immune response and they don't get such good protection from the vaccine.
Our plan was to, initially, was to vaccinate all the age groups at the same time, but we have an independent safety monitoring board and they thought we should be more conservative and do the younger people first and then move through to the older age groups, just to look at safety and monitor it as we went along.
When the trial was finally opened up to older people, I met some of the over 70s recruited in Southampton.
Was it? That's good.
Yeah, I've done it loads of times before.
Among them, Helena and her husband David, both in their 80s.
My name's Christine. I'm going to do your vaccine today.
Okay.
There we go.
Thank you.
That's
it, all done, yeah.
Oh.
I know.
I missed it.
Blink and you missed it.
Why did the two of you decide to come here today?
We're very medical, our family. I was a doctor's daughter. And we worked for the NHS, obviously, and we think anything we can do to help.
The primary aim of the vaccine is to stop people getting ill. But if it could also prevent people getting infected at all, That would help stop transmission. So the volunteers are asked to do swab tests to pick up any who may have an infection, including those without symptoms. It's become a regular event for Helena and David.
Another one done. David's making his box, but I've made mine already. We do a weekly test, which we have to send off in the post. Have to make sure we put the right sample in the right box.
And if we can reduce both the symptomatic infection and the asymptomatic infection, that might mean that vaccines could have an impact on transmission. And that's a big deal, because that means the virus could be stopped in its tracks.
By the end of the summer, trials of the vaccine were running in six countries, including the UK, Brazil, South Africa, and the United States. Nearly 20,000 volunteers had been recruited. But then, suddenly, everything stopped.
Trials of a coronavirus vaccine being developed by the pharma giant AstraZeneca and Oxford University have been paused for
a participant in that human trial has had a suspected adverse reaction. The trial is being developed with Oxford University.
On the 6th of September, all the trials were halted after a participant developed a rare neurological condition. There was concern it might have been linked to the vaccine.
When we start vaccinating large numbers of people, sometimes they will have what we call adverse events. It means anything bad that happens to them, and we have to assess it.
In a clinical trial of tens of thousands of people, stuff happens to people. People develop illnesses. There will be people who develop cancers and who develop neurological conditions. All these things happen in human populations. And the difficulty in clinical trials is to work out whether it's associated with the intervention, the vaccine in our case in the trial, or not.
An independent safety review said they couldn't find a link to the vaccine, but couldn't rule it out either. The volunteer is now recovering and remains in the trial. Regulators in the UK, Brazil, and South Africa allowed trials to resume within days. But it was 6 weeks before they restarted in the United States. All this was in the context of a vocal anti-vaccination movement.
There is an anti-vaccine movement, and what we would like to try to do is help people to understand how the vaccine works, how much work has gone into producing it. It's not something that we thought of in January and decided to give it a go. It builds on years and years of experience and understanding how to make vaccines in a safe way, how to test vaccines in a safe way, and what we need to do to get a vaccine that's going to protect people against this terrible disease.
Nothing in life is 100% safe. There are risks associated with everything we do. There are risks with getting in a car, there are risks with drinking alcohol, there are risks with going on planes. And it's the same when we take medicines. You know, paracetamol is not safe, but we all take it. There are very tiny risks associated with all vaccines, but we accept them, and we accept that the risk of not being vaccinated is far, far greater.
Okay. Good. Try that again. That's lovely. Yeah, nice and relaxed. Good.
That's it, a bit lower.
No clinical trials had ever had this kind of global attention. Scientists had become celebrities.
How do you feel about being in the public eye?
I would rather just get on with the science, but it's important to explain the science to people.
And what about all the media attention?
It's been awful. Sorry, but it's been awful. Can't say that to you, can I? But it's just not why we do it, and we don't like it. There's cameras in your face. It's not something that we got into our career to do.
The pressure has been pretty intense during the course of this year.
I feel much better if I get out and do some running and just to clear the head and get away from it all for at least for an hour or two every now and then.
Everyone is doing this because they're trying to do some good for the world. And when you get a lot of the negative press and the criticism, it's actually really, really tough. And this has been, for me, probably the toughest thing I've ever worked on in terms of the goldfish bowl environment that you're in, where every single thing is scrutinized, politicized, turned around, misrepresented.
The virus is doubling faster than we can conceivably add capacity. And so now is the time to take action because there is no alternative.
By the beginning of November, COVID hospital admissions were rising as a second wave swept across much of the UK. The need for a vaccine was clearer than ever.
So we've actually got back to the vaccine being manufactured at the moment.
Global production had begun, and by now AstraZeneca had committed to 3 billion doses in 2021. That meant scaling up production at home and abroad, such as at this company, Oxford Biomedica, where they grow it in bioreactors.
What we do is we then infect those cells with the viral seed stock for the vaccine. Once it's then produced it, we harvest it and start to purify it to remove all of the impurities.
So this is like vaccine MasterChef then? All these people are playing a different role in growing this and creating it?
They're all different chefs in there with all the specialities.
AstraZeneca has also signed deals in Russia, Australia, Brazil, and with India's Serum Institute, the world's biggest vaccine manufacturer. These will be essential for global access to the vaccine. The formula is the same worldwide. It was a team led by Sandy Douglas that worked out how to produce the vaccine at scale.
It's a little bit like developing the recipe for Coke. So it takes quite a long time to get the recipe just right. But once you have that recipe, it's like a template and it can be transferred to all sorts of different manufacturing organizations around the world. And that's exactly what we've done.
Some vaccines must be transported at ultra low temperatures, but this one can be kept at around 4 degrees.
Being able to store the vaccines in a fridge is game changing. If you have to store vaccines on dry ice at minus 80 degrees centigrade, that just brings additional challenges to how to get it into villages in the UK, let alone villages in sub-Saharan Africa and Brazil. And a vaccine that can be stored in a normal fridge, in my fridge here or anybody else's, and then given to a person, that changes everything.
We've wanted to make as much of it as we possibly could. And we've wanted to make sure that it's available in as many places as possible. And so we took some key strategic decisions early on to make sure that that would happen.
By early November, trials of several vaccines, each involving tens of thousands of volunteers, were nearing completion. Scientists were anxiously waiting for independent data analysts to tell them when enough COVID cases had been accumulated to determine whether the vaccines offered any protection.
I've worked in vaccines for long enough to know that most vaccines actually don't work. I've worked on clinical trials for malaria where we get no protection, and it's the worst feeling in the world to have such high expectations and then to see nothing. So there's a mixture of anticipation, but also tinged with a little bit of, oh, I really hope it works.
Could this be the moment the world has been waiting for? An effective vaccine against COVID-19. It's been developed by the US drugs company Pfizer and a German manufacturer, BioNTech.
It felt like a historic moment. We are winning this battle. That's my belief today.
The first results were spectacular. Pfizer's vaccine had efficacy or trial effectiveness of nearly 95%. Moderna, a week later, announced the same astonishing levels of protection.
I broke into an ear-to-ear grin when I heard the numbers. It really exceeded our best hopes.
Do we now say with confidence that life should be returning to normal by spring?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Expectations were raised regarding what Oxford AstraZeneca might deliver. And the following weekend, Andrew Pollard, the head of the global trials, was told the results.
I was exhausted at that moment and went in and was very pleased to see that we had got efficacy of the vaccine. What was going to happen next was to try, you know, and start the disclosures, which had to be to other colleagues here in Oxford, including Sarah, about the results.
I was at home on a Saturday evening reading a book. I was quite surprised to get a message from Andy Pollard saying, could I get in touch, please?
We were in the middle of quarterfinals of MasterChef and the phone rang and I picked it up and it was my head of respiratory and immunology who was calling me to tell me the results. And of course, the first question is, has it worked? And the answer was, yes, we've got a vaccine.
I was a little hazy because I hadn't expected to get that call at that time. And I pretty much stopped them and I just said, do we have efficacy or not? I was told yes, and then the rest of it was a blur.
The vaccine worked. The results showed it offered protection and was safe. Among more than 11,000 volunteers on the trial in the UK and Brazil, there were 101 cases of COVID in the control group and 30 in those that got the coronavirus vaccine. That's an overall protection of 70%, better than most seasonal flu jabs. In the control group, 10 people were hospitalized with serious COVID and one died. In those that got the coronavirus vaccine, no one got seriously ill with COVID.
It's very, very important that we made a vaccine that protect against severe disease. That's what vaccines should do and should achieve. And the fact that nobody we vaccinated got severe disease is hugely important.
The key point here is that it's a highly efficacious vaccine that is going to have a huge impact on the pandemic if we can get it licensed and then rolled out.
The vaccine has key advantages over Pfizer and Moderna's. It doesn't need to be kept at minus 70 degrees, and at £3 a dose, it's at least five times cheaper. Early Monday morning, the results were made public.
Some news just in. Oxford University and the pharmaceutical firm AstraZeneca have published the preliminary results from large-scale trials of their coronavirus vaccine, showing that it's 70% effective at preventing the disease.
I was in bed in my pyjamas when I found out. I woke up to texts from friends and family congratulating me, and I immediately checked my emails and saw that it had been released. I was absolutely over the moon. I was so happy. And then I had to sort of swallow all my excitement and go off to work and do my shift.
It was on the TV, my WhatsApp starts going off. Oh my God, your vaccine's out! All my friends are like, yay! It was a good day, Monday. Got home, a colleague from college had left a magnum of English fizz in my porch.
Nice.
Which I did not drink because I'm by myself and the magnum of fizz is too much for one person, even on the Monday that your vaccine's been proved efficacious.
I was expecting the result to be in the format of we have this number of cases and it's this level of efficacy, and it turned out not to be quite as simple.
In fact, they ended up with three numbers. Overall efficacy was 70%. Two full doses gave 62% protection. But the smaller group of volunteers given an initial half dose had 90% protection, a result no one had expected.
Well, having three figures was a surprise and certainly complicates the story and the communication of it.
I think, first of all, I thought, thank goodness it's working. And secondly, I was thinking, that's going to be quite difficult to explain.
So how can an initial lower dose of vaccine deliver greater protection? The scientists themselves are still unsure.
I didn't really understand exactly why we were seeing those results, and I'm sure that was everybody else's reaction as well. But what really matters is understanding whether it's a real result. And there are a number of other things in the trial that are internally consistent, which tell us that this is a real result.
But the complexity of the findings and the confusion over dosing levels spark criticism.
Development questions mounting over AstraZeneca and Oxford's vaccine candidate.
AstraZeneca and Oxford are defending their COVID vaccine trials following some big questions that are being asked about how the candidate
was actually
being
an error,
tested.
One that turned out to be a very fortunate one.
Some felt the efficacy didn't compare well to Pfizer and Moderna.
I'm not sure about you, Carolyn, but I think I'm going to be signing up for the 95% efficacy vaccine rather than the maybe 70%, maybe 60%, maybe 90% vaccine.
Jennifer Rogers is an independent statistician who specializes in analyzing clinical trial results.
So when these results came out, we had three numbers, whereas in the other announcements, we just had the one single number. I think that generated a bit of suspicion as to whether or not results were being cherry-picked. We also then found out that we had this low dose, standard dose mistake that happened. Then we found out that that had only happened in the 18 to 55 age group. So we didn't even know whether or not this worked in anybody over the age of 55. There would just seem to be these little mistakes and more got entangled as the days went on.
Pfizer and Moderna, it was pretty simple and they did end up with just one result.
Yeah.
Has part of the headache been because you've got partly different dosing, but partly different countries, and it's just made the whole thing just more complex than one would have hoped for in an ideal world?
Look, I think there is no doubt, I think, that we would have run the study a little bit differently if we'd been doing it from scratch. But ultimately, it is what it is, and I think the Oxford group have done a fantastic job, and then we've done as good a job as we possibly can to translate that into the data set that we can provide to the regulators and to regions around the world for the approval.
In terms of the half dose, full dose, they were people who were 18 to 55 that you got that 90% efficacy in. Is that potentially problematic? Because obviously the people you most want to protect are the over 65s, and so you've only got that really high efficacy in a younger age group.
Yeah, so again, you're absolutely right that we have that efficacy signal in a younger age group. We've also shown in a different part of the study that the way that the patients respond to the vaccine are exactly the same, 18 to 55, 55 and above. So we actually haven't seen any difference in the way people respond to the vaccine by age.
In the space of a year, you've managed to come up with a vaccine, trial it, and hopefully before the end of the year, get it approved. Some people are going to say, well, it's all gone a bit quick. I mean, how would you reassure people?
Well, it doesn't feel to me like it's been very quick. It seems to have taken about 10 years to get to this point. But I think in the end, the processes we've gone through are just the same and just as rigorous as in normal times. I mean, it's absolutely a key part of the reason why we do the trials is to establish the safety of the vaccines that we're testing.
Why would people choose your vaccine, not one that's better?
Well, we need all of the vaccines in order to have an impact in the pandemic. I think the key test for all of the vaccines is that they are used and that we start seeing a change in the pandemic. I don't think we should be looking at the numbers and trying to decide which one is better or the other. We need people vaccinated, and that's got to happen soon if we want to get back to normal.
Last week, the Oxford team published an analysis of their trial data in a medical journal, The Lancet. This transparency has reassured experts.
So now I think we are certain that they haven't cherry-picked the analyses, and that will have been done in coordination with the regulators. We also know that this low-dose, standard dose, yes, it did happen as a mistake, but was handled appropriately. The regulators were consulted at all times. I look at this data and I see a vaccine that shows all the promise of working. It looks like it's really good at preventing severe coronavirus, and there doesn't seem to be any safety concerns. I saw these results and I was positive. I think it's great news.
It's really important to appreciate you don't necessarily need 100% effective vaccine, because if I'm vaccinated, I protect myself, and I hope to some degree I'm protecting others. It's not a competition between vaccines. We need multiple vaccines, and we've got to have them at scale for the whole world. And I would worry less about whether one is 60 or 70 and one's 80 or 90. I think they'll both be incredibly effective.
The medical regulator, the MHRA, has been conducting a rolling review of the vaccine trials. It could decide within weeks whether to grant emergency approval and what dose should be given. But in the US, where a trial is still taking place, their regulator, the FDA, might take longer.
Do they want to see those results of that trial in the US before they say yay or nay? Or could they just say, yes, we've got a global pandemic here, give us your vaccine?
So I think, you know, we will take them through the data set, but my assumption is that they will want to see the US data as well.
So that might then mean waiting a few months.
Weeks. We're recruiting a lot of people every day, and event rates are pretty high in the US at the moment.
We still don't know how effective the vaccine is in older people, how long protection lasts, or if it stops virus transmission. But for now, time to reflect.
How does it feel to have got this far in this journey?
It's a relief at this stage that all of the work that people have done during the year and all of the money that's been spent on manufacturing large amounts of this vaccine is not going to go to waste. It's quite a responsibility to say to people, you have to manufacture this vaccine now because we have to have a lot of doses ready to go. And we know it, we don't know if it works yet, but we can't wait, so get on with it.
A vaccine that we have made that went out into the world is actually stopping people getting sick. Huge thing for us. I think we all had a little cry. it's a bit, you know, it was worth it because we'd worked really hard.
My son said something to me the other day that really impacted me, and I was apologizing for being late home for work again. And he said, it's okay, Mummy, you're doing it for everybody. It's not just me you need to look after. And that did bring a tear to my eye.
So what are you looking forward to in the future?
You're going to make me emotional. I haven't seen my mum since last Christmas.
Really?
Yeah, she's in Greece. And she's on her own, so that's tough. Yeah. It's been tough. Sorry. Just take a moment. Sorry.
Over the course of the year, it's been an emotional journey for everyone working on the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. 4 million doses are ready to be handed over to the NHS. If approved, every adult in the country could be offered a jab next year. The government hopes by Easter, most over 65s and vulnerable groups will be protected. A chance for life to finally return to normal.
I think science has been the exit strategy for this pandemic, and I think vaccines are at the heart of that scientific endeavour. And here we are with COVID, 10 months, 11 months into it, and the scientific endeavour globally has produced those tools to bring the pandemic to a close.
I just think from personal experience, like, my style